Let's start. So the traditional Fulbright Award, for those that are not yet familiar with what it is an award that it's available every year for Canadian students that are interested in doing studies or, graduate studies or undertaking a research project in the US. This is an award that will provide the successful candidates $20,000 for a full academic year. It's an award that it's open to most disciplines, and it can be used in terms of graduate programs for masters that are thesis and non-thesis based. So some people sometimes ask if they could apply for a program that does not involve a thesis, and that should not be a problem. You can apply to those type of programs. The award is intended for Canadian citizens who are in one of these three categories. They might be graduate students at the Canadian university, so you might be doing your master or PhD studies in Canada. You can also be prospective graduate students at a US institution, so you are seeking admission into a graduate program in the US, or you can also be an independent researcher. Independent research are students that finished an undergraduate degree and would like to do research after that, or that finished a master degree and would like to do research after the master degree. The awards can be held in the United States at any accredited university, research center, think tank, or government agency. So we don't have, so if you're doing research, you don't necessarily need to be at a university. However, you do need to be at an institution that has a good reputation for the type of research that you intend to do. The award has three different modalities. So, like I mentioned, it can be used for formal enrollment. It can be used for pursuing research during a graduate program in Canada, or it can be used as independent research. Let's look a bit into each of these three modalities. So the first one, formal enrollment awards. This is intended for students who plan to enroll in a graduate program at a US university. And one important aspect is that you need to seek admission in the program at the same time that you're applying for the Fulbright Award. And this is because we are only able to provide financing for the first year of a graduate program. Some students contact us when they are already enrolled in the program. And in those cases, we are not able to support your program because you don't meet this requirement of having seeking funding for the first year of the program. And some of you also ask us if is there any problem in applying without a letter of admission, because we understand that some admissions may come after the deadline for the Fulbright grant, and that's not a problem. You can apply while in the process of seeking admission. But we will also address this later on in the frequently asked questions that we have towards the end of the presentation. The second modality is the research award, that it's intended for students that are currently enrolled in a graduate program at a Canadian university and who wish to conduct research in the United States to support their Canadian degree. So if you're doing a master degree that involves a research year, or obviously a PhD that involves research, you can seek a Fulbright grant to do your research or part of the research in the US. All of these awards will support you for a full academic year. So when you see a 9-month period, we are basically talking about a full academic year. Finally, independent research is intended for researchers who have completed an undergraduate degree or a master's degree at a Canadian university and wish to pursue one academic year of independent research in the US. So as you can see, this award is pretty flexible. The only thing is that you need to make sure that you're applying under one of these conditions so that you're eligible to receive the award. The general guidelines for eligibility require that the candidates are Canadian citizens. They cannot be U.S. citizens or permanent residents of Canada or from the or the U.S. or have been born in the U.S. They should also not be living, enrolled, or working in the United States during the previous or the current academic year. The undergraduate degree must be completed before the start of the Fulbright grant. You must have proficiency in English. You must not have resided abroad for 5 or more consecutive years in the 6-year period immediately preceding the date of the application. So this is relevant for example, candidates that may have lived abroad during an undergraduate degree, for example, or whose parents may have worked abroad and the candidate was living with them at the time. Also, we would not be able to finance enrollment in medical degree programs. And if you already have a PhD degree, then the student award is not aimed at you. Then we have a different modality called the scholar awards. The financial support that the award provides is a grant for $20,000. This money is meant to offset most of the costs of living in the US. So we would expect candidates to cover all of their expenses using this money. However, we are not keeping a close track of the usage of the money, but you need to be aware that there is no extra funding. This is all that's available. Now let's look a bit into the application and some tips to make a strong application. So in the application, one of the most important elements for a successful application relates to the statement of study or research that you need to write. So this is a document that should not have more than 4 pages. And it's a document that you need to write either if you're applying for a research or for a full degree in the US. In this document, there are specific elements that you need to focus. One of those elements is your commitment to the US community and describe how you will engage with it. Also develop an intellectual, compelling, and feasible project, or in case you're applying for a graduate program, justify why you are pursuing a specific degree in the US. Other elements that are relevant in this document is, contrary to the instructions that you see on the application platform, you can indicate the US institutions that you're interested in attending or attending for study or conduct research. And it's very important that your statement or that your project, that your that the description can be easily understood for people that are not experts in your field. Because the reviewers obviously are not experts in all fields. So they basically need to grasp what is the project that you're proposing or the reasons for why you want to study in the US. Specifically for applicants proposing research projects, it's very important that you address most of the topics, most of the items that are listed here. What do you propose to do? Why do you want to undertake the project? What is innovative about the project that you're proposing? The specific research goals and methodology, what is important or significant about the project that should receive a Fulbright Award, what contribution will the project make toward the Fulbright goal of promoting cultural exchange and enhancing mutual understanding, why does the project have to be conducted in the US, what are your qualifications for carrying out this project, how will the project help further your academic or professional development, and how will you engage with the host country community? So these are elements that should be addressed for candidates specifically looking to apply for a project in the US. If you're applying for a graduate degree, then there are some questions that are applied to you. So which program are you applying? Where do you propose to enroll and what are the reasons? Why do you want to pursue the proposed program? Why enroll in a program in the US? What are your reasons for selecting the program? What is the timeline? how do you meet the requisite academic and field-specific background to undertake the proposed program? Once again, what contribution will your enrollment in the program make towards the Fulbright goal of promoting cultural exchange and enhancing mutual understanding? And do you have the flexibility and dynamism necessary for active involvement in the US? So, as you can see, there are two big components in both of these in both of the items that are listed here. One is your how prepared are you to undertake the project, and the other is how you plan to adjust and adapt to the reality of being in the US and contribute to the spread of knowledge once you finish your project or finish your degree. In addition to that document, you also need to write a personal statement. So this is a shorter document, no more than 2 pages. And in this document, you should provide a narrative about yourself. It should deal with elements such as your personal history, family background, influences on your intellectual development, the education, professional, and cultural opportunities to which you have been exposed, the ways in which these experiences have affected you, include special interests, abilities, career plans, and life goals. So this is something where you will basically try to convince the reviewer of what are the things that you have done so far, and also the things that you expect to achieve, and how a Fulbright fits within this life goal that you have and the experiences that you have accumulated so far. The review committee will look at specific elements when they are assessing applications. One of the most important things are the merits of the proposal, the research and design methodology or study plan. So depending if you're doing research or planning to do a full graduate program, the suitability of your academic training or professional experience, how feasible is the project that you're proposing, and what is their potential to advance knowledge in a particular field? Why do you need to go to the US to complete the research? So one of the questions that they may ask is, why isn't this student doing this in Canada and needs to go to the US? And also the project's potential impact. In terms of the immigration and visa requirements, all Canadian Fulbrighters will enter the US under a J-1 visa. You may be accompanied by dependents, which would be eligible for a J-2 visa. Dual US-Canadian citizens are not eligible. And once you finish your degree or your project, you are required to return for Canada for 2 years. You can still travel to the US. However, you may not be able to look for employment or permanent residency in the US. And while taking up your grant in the United States, you are also permitted to come back to Canada for short periods of time. We will talk a bit more about visas in a subsequent section. The timeline for the application and the review process. From May to November 15, the competition opens, and it's when candidates submit all the applications. We don't review any applications before the deadline, so there's no first come, first serve basis. Everything waits until the deadline. In December, it's where applications are assessed for eligibility and completeness. Next year, January, the adjudication committee meets to rank the applications and make recommendations. In February, the board of directors reviews or approves the committee recommendations. In March, the William Fulbright Foreign Scholarship Board reviews the applications that were recommended. And in April, all selected and unselected candidates are notified. So if you are wondering what is the process after you complete after you submit your application, this is basically what will happen. Now, and based on the contacts that we have with candidates, we have compiled a series of questions and answers that we can say are the most popular. So Hopefully this will answer most of your questions. If it doesn't, you can still use the chat box and we will try to tackle any questions that you may have. So the first question is, I'm a citizen of both Canada and the US. Can I still apply? So by now you should know the answer to this question if you were seeing our previous slides. No, because applicants enter the US with a J1 visa, this visa is not available for people that are US citizens, and therefore they are not able to apply for a grant to go from Canada to the US with a Fulbright grant if they have dual citizenship. By dual, we mean Canadian US citizenship. Can I apply to a graduate program which may take more than 1 year to complete? Yes. You can receive a Fulbright award that will always support your first academic year. Although the award is not renewable, your visa can be renewed until the end of your program, and it can be transferred to your host institution until the end of your studies. I have received my master's degree, but will not start my PhD for another year. Can I use a Fulbright award to conduct research in a gap year if I have the intention of remaining in the US for a PhD afterwards? So no. If at the time of the application you do not indicate that it's your intention to enter the United States for the purpose of a degree program that will last longer than a 9-month period, then you are obliged to return to Canada for 2 years upon the completion of your award. So please do make sure that whenever you're receiving the award, that is very clear the duration of your entire program so that we can prepare things accordingly. Do I need to have a letter of invitation? So if you're applying for a graduate program, yes, you do need the letter of invitation. However, if you're applying for, it's the other way around. If you're applying for a research project, yes, you do need a letter of invitation. But if you're applying for a graduate program, you will need a letter of admission, which is a different thing. Sometimes the letter of invitation, and this is just additional information, can come from a supervisor or from someone that has the authority to invite you to go to a particular institution. So we don't have a specific person that we can only accept letters of invitation from. It can be anyone that has the authority to invite you to go there. And in the letter of invitation, basically explain what you will be doing there and for how long. I have not yet received a letter of invitation or acceptance. Am I eligible to apply? So we do understand that the application deadline may not coincide with the deadline of the admissions office or eventually the supervisor or whoever writes your letter of invitation may not be available exactly during the period of the application. So what we always recommend is that if you're able to receive these documents before the deadline for the Fulbright application, please upload them. If you are not, you can include copies of your correspondence or acknowledgement of receipt that you have applied for admission in your Fulbright application. So you can include screenshots or PDFs of emails that you receive or any other document that gives us an idea that you're seeking admission into a specific program. If you are successful in your application, then before the scholarship starts, you are required to provide the final admission letter or a letter of invitation before you are able to receive the scholarship. But that, as you saw before in the timeline, it only takes place mid next year. Do I need to submit GRE results with my Fulbright application? At Fulbright, we do not require GRE results for candidates to be able to apply. However, your program might require it. And if that's the case, then you need to provide that with your application to the program, not to the Fulbright. who should write my reference letters? The reference letters are one very important part of the application. These letters should clearly show that you are ready to undertake either the graduate program or the research project that you're proposing, and should speak highly about your skills as a student, as a researcher, and should definitely shine a very bright light on your application in general. It's very important that you provide to your referees either the project statement that you're submitting with your application, or the rationale for the project of study that you're submitting, so that they can write based also on what you're describing in that document. So you should contact professors or professionals that know you very well and that can speak highly about your skills to undertake a project or a graduate program in the US. My mother tongue is English. Must I complete a language proficiency test? No. Only if your mother tongue is not English are you required to complete such proficiency test. Also in situations that you may not have completed at least 3 years of study or work in English are you required to submit the proficiency test. However, from experience, most applicants do not need such tests because they have done their studies in Canada. So that's and in English, and that's something that will automatically waive this requirement. However, if you have studied in French, then it's a different issue, because you have not been able to provide evidence that you have studied in English. And if your mother tongue is French, if you're a native in both languages, that can waive this requirement because you also have as a mother tongue English. However, if that's not the case, then you would need to provide such evidence that you have proficiency in English. How is my application reviewed and how am I notified? So your application will be reviewed in 4 main stages. The first one is review for eligibility, content, and completeness. So basically making sure that everything is as it's supposed to be in terms of documentation and the information that it's provided. Then there's an academic review conducted by an adjudication committee that consists mainly of academics and professionals from Canada. After that, there's a review by the Fulbright Canada Board of Directors. And finally, there's a review by the William Fulbright Foreign Scholarship Board. So once all of this is completed, the final results are announced. Can awards be deferred? Unfortunately, we are not able to defer awards. So awards must be used for the year for which the application was made. If you are unable to take an award, you can withdraw and you can apply in future years. The fact that you have withdrawn, it will not be looked upon as a negative thing in future applications, because the review is not looking to past applications to see if you applied or not. So if you cannot take an award, don't worry, you can always reapply without any negative impact. Do I have to return to Canada after completing studies or research? Yes. So like I mentioned before, you will need to return to Canada for 2 years. And this needs to take place after you finish your research project or after you finish your graduate program. So we have been able to cover this in less time than I expected. So now we can look into the questions that you have. And if you have additional questions, you can write them on the chat box and we will try to answer any questions that you may have. The first question that I have here is if the awards are only for master or for PhDs. It's for both. So as you have realized during the presentation, this is for graduate programs in the US, so both masters and PhDs. The second question, it refers to seeking admission at the time of applying for the Fulbright. What if the student has already been accepted in the program, but the application has been deferred to next year? So it is my understanding that if you already have a letter of invitation or a letter of admission, that's even better, because you can already submit that with your application. And as long as you have not started your program, it should be fine. Right now, all of the applications that are coming in should be for programs starting in the fall of 2021. So we are talking roughly September next year. In some cases, if the program starts a bit earlier, we are able to accommodate that. But if the program starts early next year, or in the first months of 2021, we are not able to process applications in such a short period of time. Does the admission have to be completed when you apply for a Fulbright? No, like I said, we understand that some results of admission are only known early next year, and you can submit the final confirmation later on. So at this point, you do not need to submit final confirmation that you have been admitted. Can the research project be one page? It can be one page. However, as you saw, there are several items that you need to write about. So it will be probably very, very hard to put all of that in one page, and probably your application won't be as or the description won't be as rich as if you take more space. Will I be able to access the recording of this session? This is an easy question, yes. So is there an age cutoff? Not that I'm aware. So I have a colleague on the line. Brad, is there an age cutoff for the student award? I don't think there is, but.
You're right, Paulo. We accept applicants from all stages in their career. So, yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Brad. So the other question, another question that we have here, I'm not sure what you mean in enrolling to a U.S. program. Do you mean enroll as a visiting student? Yes. It's enrolling to undertake a graduate program. That's basically the logic. Other universities have visiting assistant in research program. Would something like this count as enrollment? So, like I said, you can apply for the Fulbright Award in two main modalities, as a researcher or as a student enrolled in a full-time program. So if you are applying under one of these scenarios, you are eligible for a Fulbright Award. If there is something else that does not fit, either as a visiting student doing research or as a formal full-time graduate student, then that is not applicable for this grant. How many recommendations should I submit? So you need three recommendations. If I'm seeking to pursue a doctoral program, which set of questions should I answer in my statement of study? So like I said, so for graduate programs, you should answer the questions that relate to study, because you will be applying for a graduate degree. So a graduate degree is considered it's a study program. It's not a research. Someone said, I finished a term in the first year of my grad degree. Am I still eligible? So if you already started your program in the US, you're not eligible anymore. What if I already studied in English, my university and postgraduate studies, how many awards? I don't understand this question, sorry. I'm wondering if someone is applying to a doctoral degree, is it appropriate to also talk about my proposed research as well as other reasons for the program itself? So, sure, if you're applying for a PhD and you already know what you want to do as research for your PhD, you can include additional wording on the project that you would like to undertake under your PhD program. Yes, that's fine. However, The only thing that sometimes you may not be able to address is specific details like the methodology. So in those cases, it's fine. You don't need to go as in much detail as if you were applying just for a research project, but you can definitely speak about the research that you would like to undertake during your PhD degree. How is COVID influencing cross-border Fulbright process? So, because all of these awards are for September 2021, we are unable to tell you how things will be at that time and how will the border be at that time. Because the situation is basically evolving every week, we are unable to make any comments as of this time in regards to what will be the outcome of this particular cohort when the time comes to take up the award. So what we advise is please just stay tuned. And if you do receive the award, we will provide you more information about all of these things in due time. I'm a Canadian citizen and I did my bachelor's degree in Canada. I recently started a master with a European university, but I'm planning to do my thesis with a research group at MIT. Am I eligible for the award? Would I apply under the research or independent research? Jessica, the independent research is the same as the research category. So it's there's only one research category. If you are enrolled in a program, in a graduate program, you will be doing the research allocated to your graduate program. You would not be an independent researcher because independent researchers are people that are not registered in any graduate degree. But once again, Brad, I would like your take in this. Canadian students that are doing a graduate degree outside of Canada, so not in the US, in this case in Europe, would there be any issue in applying for a Fulbright to go to the US?
We have received several applications in the past, people going to Oxford or London School of Economics or places like that who are Canadians doing some postgraduate work overseas and then taking up a Fulbright, returning to finish their studies, then coming back to Canada afterwards. So this is a common occurrence.
Okay. So yeah, you let me just see who wrote this. So Jessica, yes, you should be able to apply and be considered for this award. If someone has a PhD but applying for another graduate degree in a different field for well substantiated reason, is that individual allowed to apply for the student award? So I will need your assistance here again, Brad. Someone that already has a PhD but wants to apply for another graduate degree, what would be our take on this situation?
Yes, because they are applying for a graduate degree, they are technically a student at that point, so they are eligible to apply.
Okay. However, you should provide a very good reason why you're applying for another graduate degree when you already have a PhD, James. So just keep that in mind. What is typically uploaded under additional documents? Are there any tips or guidance on how to use this section? So one thing that it's probably good to mention is the application platform is an application platform that is used by different countries. And because of that, not all fields are applicable to all countries. In Canada, we don't have any requirement to upload any specific documentation under additional documents. I don't know if from experience, Brad, people have uploaded things in additional documentation that turned out to be relevant. I don't have any specific guideline or tip in this case. I don't know if there's anything else that you would like to have.
Well, in the early days of the platform, the additional documents would have been for a place for people to upload their English language proficiency report, for example.
Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, like I said, it's not a field that we are currently using. Some of these questions are related to how many scholarships are provided and what is the success rate. We are not able to go into details on how many applications are received or how many applications receive the award. Generally speaking, all we can say is, and this is something that you find in the website, Depending on the year and depending on the numbers, we may have between 20 to 30% of applications that are successful. So this is the only information that we can provide you, because every year, depending on how many people apply, obviously this percentage changes. Someone is mentioning, I'm applying for the award now. Does it mean that I can't come to the US for 2 months of research starting February 2021 as part of my master's? I would need your input here, Brad. So if someone is applying now, and if they enter the US to do research on February next year, what is the impact of that in regards to receiving a Fulbright for September, for example?
So the timing, like you mentioned, Paolo, is that these Fulbright awards are going to be taken up in the 2021-2022 academic year. It means starting in August, September of next year. If they wanted to use this Fulbright award to support research done in February, then they should have applied for the last cycle.
Yeah. Even if they are, for example, waiting for September, but they enter the US before, so in February, I guess this could be a negative impact if they afterwards receive the scholarship for September.
Well, keep in mind what the objective of these programs is: to encourage people to go to the United States, people who wouldn't otherwise be able to. And if they're already in the United States or taking up a residential period, like 3 month or blocks or 4 months or a year, this is what we're trying to do. And if somebody's already done that, then we'll have a preference for somebody who's not already having that experience.
Yeah, that's a good point. So please keep that in mind, what Brad just mentioned. If the review committee is, if you recall, there is a point that you need to make in your statement as to why you need a Fulbright to go to the US. So if at any point the review thinks that the Fulbright is not really necessary for you to go to the US because you already will go there anyway, then there's a big probability that your application may not be as competitive as someone else that doesn't have that opportunity. So someone is asking if they can apply for Fulbright for an MBA program. Yes, as far as I'm aware, that should be fine. If I'm applying for a program that requires a portfolio, how many submissions would be sufficient? So I guess you only have to submit one portfolio. Has there been cases of people submitting more than one, Brad, for the application?
Typically, no. These are, I guess, a little more demanding in these types of questions, but normally no.
Okay. So this question is also for you, Brad. Is it possible to be exempted from obtaining a J-1 visa if our host institution is sponsoring us for a different visa?
I guess the question is, does that mean the person is already in country? Which case then there's not a need for them to take a Fulbright. The Fulbright are for people who have not already been there. It is possible, and I'll just touch on this because I think I saw one of the questions in there that say, once they finish their Fulbright, can they continue on their studies? So for example, you're taking a master's or 2 years master's program, the Fulbright will have the J-1 visa to help support your first year. At the end of that 1 year period, you can transfer sponsorship from Fulbright to the host institution to continue on your studies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in the topic of visas, is there, there's also another question here regarding the need to return to Canada for 2 years after the completion of studies. If the student applies, for example, for an, I think it's O-1 visa, an artist visa, or a green card after studies, do they still need to come back? So do you have experience of students or candidates trying to apply for other visas, Brad, after they receive the Fulbright?
So the getting a visa process where you're applying for a visa, the government's going to be looking at your past history. And I know that if you're applying for an H, L, or a K visa, or a J visa, or you're applying for lawful permanent residency, like getting a green card or something like that, they say, well, you have to meet your return residency requirement before you move forward on that. An artist visa, I'm not familiar with that, but that's not among the ones listed. So, or even a TN visa is not among the ones listed that are excluded. So I can't be 100% certain on this, but I'm just following the guidelines that they're providing for us on the exclusions.
Okay. Someone is asking, what is the national identification number for Canadian applicants? So I don't think this is applicable for Canadians. Some countries do have a national identification number. So once again, that's probably one of the fields in the platform that it's meant for other countries.
Yeah, and I'll add to that. So for Canada, the national identification number would be a social insurance number. Because that is linked to banking and information, that would be something we would need should you be selected for an award. If you're applying, please don't send us that information because we don't need it and you shouldn't be sharing it unless it's required for financial reasons.
So there's another COVID-related question. So once again, we are not able to answer this at this point. Someone is asking if we need to withdraw or we can delay acceptance. Once again, we would need to wait and see what would be the scenario at the time and the options. If I'm selected for the award and I'm not admitted to my proposed program, but I am admitted to a different US institution, can I use the award at that other institution? I would need your input here, Brett. I'm not sure how to address this.
So the quick answer is maybe. So there has been cases where somebody's not been accepted at the original institution or plans have fallen through and they've asked for an adjustment. It's okay to ask for an adjustment. There'll just have to be a short review with our office to ensure that the essence of your original Fulbright is being project and proposal as being followed. If it's a significant change, we may have to reconsider, but it is possible that adjustments can be made.
Okay. So one other question for which I would need your input, Brad. Someone is asking if they finish, so if they receive a Fulbright to undertake a master's degree in the US, and then they also, after the master, they are admitted in the PhD at the same institution, would they be able to continue and finish the PhD and then return to Canada?
Historically, that has happened. And as I mentioned before, it's a matter of transferring sponsorship from Fulbright to your host institution.
Okay. Yeah. So you could do that, Taylor. So someone is saying, I will pursue a PhD that is research focused. Should I spend more time in the research proposal addressing the program related information? I'll spend more time arguing the research project itself. So, Anna, we don't have an answer set in stone for something like this. I guess this all depends on how much detail will you have about your project. So if you have a lot of detail about your project, then yes, you could elaborate about the project that you're undertaking, but ultimately you're applying for a graduate degree. So you need to provide a rationale on why you're applying to that specific degree, why you need to go to the US to do that degree, which experience or academic skills do you have to undertake such degree. So even if you want to focus on the research, please don't forget that you need to provide the rationale of why you should receive a grant to do that degree in the US. Do I need the three references before the deadline? So ideally, the references should come before the deadline. If that's not possible at all because the professor is not answering your emails or the person has delayed the writing of the reference letter, let us know if you need more time. We are as flexible as we can be, but at a certain point, we do need to receive the documentation. So if things are not ready by November 15, what we recommend is please send them as soon as possible after that date. If a scholarship recipient does not return to Canada, will the scholarship be refunded? So, Cynthia, we would like everyone to follow the rules for which the scholarships are that govern the scholarship. So we are not upfront saying that the person will need to do this or that. But if by any chance you feel that you're not able to return to Canada after the scholarship, then it's probably better to seek funding elsewhere. What about online programs? Are they still are they eligible? So this is a good question. Online programs are not eligible. We would need candidates to be able to be in the US. There's another question about online programs. It's exactly the same thing. Does Fulbright support Canadian students enroll in largely online? No. This is another online. Okay, what about students that were awarded the Fulbright last year but ended up deferring? Did they lose their Fulbright and will thus be reapplying this year? Does this impact applications for this year? So if I understand correctly, and Brad, correct me if this is not the case, if you are not able to take the award when you applied, then you need to reapply, and you will not have any negative outcome because you didn't receive the award last year or you withdraw the award. Go ahead.
Yes, that's right. So typically, if you're unable to take up an award, then you have to withdraw and then you apply for the next cycle. Yep. This year has been exceptional, and there's been a lot of discussions, and they've actually made a one-year exclusion on this. And I think the word deferral has come up, although it's very dependent upon the situation on the ground. So we are coordinating with our students and scholars on the options available for them moving forward. They are permitted, well, there is, given circumstances, we are trying to make sure everyone gets a chance to take up their award. If not by the end of the summer, then by the end of December. There is an option, but they have to meet some conditions on that. And this is not something expected to be going forward. Now, I think the other side of that question was, will this affect people applying for this cycle? We have funding blocks, and these awards are not affecting the funding blocks for the awards being taken from the 21-22 academic year. So we are not expecting there to be any issues with a decreased number of successful applicants, if that's what your question is. Mm-hmm.
So someone is asking, I've done a 3-month internship in the US. Would this experience affect my application? So the fact that you've done an internship for 3 months, it's not a problem. I think the only thing is when you were in the US. So if you were in the US, if you were living in the US during the application cycle, so from March to November this year, that might influence the eligibility. In these cases, Brad, so if the student, for example, was for 3 months, for example, from May onwards this year, and they are applying now, I guess there might be an issue there because of the visa that they had during those 3 months.
So as of right now, I don't think we have to worry about anybody doing an internship in the United States right now.
Yeah, that's true.
So one of the concerns is whether somebody's had significant experience in the United States. You would indicate your 3-month internship on the application. That should not significantly adverse your affect the application, though, because it's a relatively small amount and it's not now. Mm-hmm. If it was happening now, at your point of application, then there would be an issue. Going back like a year or so ago, then that's perfectly okay.
Yeah. Someone is asking also, Brad, if they could apply for a short period of research, so 4 months instead of 9.
So this is something that's starting to be introduced lately. We haven't had a lot of these, but we have made a couple of I guess I would call it a pilot project where I think last year or the year before we started to permit half awards for people who are going to be going for one semester versus the full academic year. This is not being advertised because that's not the norm. Normally we want to give people the opportunity to be there an entire year. But it has happened under special circumstances where we permit somebody for a one semester award.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's a question here that it's an interesting question and probably also something that is of interest for other applicants. So someone is currently doing a master's in Canada and they would be applying for a Fulbright to go to the US to do 1 year of research in the master's degree. And then they would come back to Canada for a year and they would like to go back to the US after that 1 year to do a PhD. Because we said that they should remain in Canada for 2 years, is there a way to, I don't know, in the proposal or in their personal statement to explain this situation so that this could be covered in the application? So returning to Canada for 1 year instead of two, I think this is the main question here.
When your application is under consideration, we don't look at, I guess, your intention to go back to the United States within a year after that. What that should be independent of the award that we grant. The issue is whether or not the U.S. Immigration Services or will be able to issue a visa that will support your return to the United States to take up studies. Potentially you'd be going under an F1 visa perhaps, in which case there may not have as much of an issue, but if you're trying to go back under a J1 visa, there is a hard limit on the 24 month between the end of one award and taking up the next award.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So one of the things that Brad just mentioned, and it's important for everyone to realize is that all of these visa requirements are not something that it's imposed by Fulbright, but this is an immigration matter. So it's something that it's outside of our control. So we still have 5 minutes left. So let me just see what type of other questions we have here. A question that it's, can the person who writes my letter of invitation be the same person who writes my letter of reference? No, it should be two different people. Because there might be there would be issues if the same person would be writing the letter of invitation and the reference letter. So please choose two different people to write these two documents. There are more questions here about the returning to Canada. And once again, I think we have talked about this, and everyone should be at least much more aware of the limitations there. Let me see if we have different. Someone is mentioning here, medical science, for example, therapy and direct patient contact. If we are going to be doing therapeutic research, but we won't be doing the therapy ourselves, we will be researching the outcomes of a particular therapy, and the therapy will be done by someone else. Is that okay? So I would need your input here, Brad. So because this is related to the medical degrees and the fact that clinical trials are not eligible. In this case, what the candidate is saying is that they would be looking at the results of the therapy that it's being done by someone else.
Right. So yes, it is possible to do research on other people's activities if there is with an arm's length relationship. There is a form that talks about ethics that actually addresses to ensure that you appreciate that you know that you're not allowed to have any patient contact. That's the big part is patient contact and separation between the medical versus the research side.
So just one other question here related to returning to Canada. This is just a different perspective. Someone is asking if they return to Canada, if they need to live in Canada for 2 years or if they could go somewhere else and live in another country. So what would be your take on this, Brad?
So the only issue is if you plan to go back to the United States under an HLK visa, because what will happen is when you make that application, they're going to look to see, okay, have they returned to Canada? for that 2 year period. It's demonstrable that you're out of the country, out of the United States. Being in another country, I'm not going to recommend you take that as a course of action. It's something to look at, and the, dependent upon who's doing the assessment. See, one of the objectives of the program is to house the mutual understanding between the people of Canada and the United States. If you are here in the United States or go to visit the United States and you come back to Canada and share these experiences, that's helping improve the mutual understanding. If you return to Canada and then rush off to somewhere else, then you're sharing those experiences with people somewhere else, but you're not, but it's sort of meeting the feet of the purpose of this Canada-US exchange. And that's really what we're trying to do, is to I guess soften the edges of understanding between our peoples.
Going back to the question of the clinical trials and contact with patients, someone is asking if as a sociologist they can do research with real people. So if there's any issue with, I imagine that it's supplying surveys or just content analysis by interacting with other people. I would probably say that this should be fine. I don't know if there has been any issue regarding to this in the past, Brent.
Oh, yes. This is something that happens a lot. People go off to do interviews. There is an ethics review requirement that you have to do with your home and your host institution, just to ensure that you're in line with the guidelines that your institutions follow.
Yeah. So last question for the day. And this is related to a specific document that not everyone needs to upload, the portfolio. Someone is asking, how many artworks should I upload for my portfolio? So based on past applications, Brad, what would be your answer to how big a portfolio should be, or how many artworks should be included in such a portfolio? Is there any guidance as to this?
So I don't think you've mentioned this, Paolo. The adjudication committee is broken into three subcommittees. One is the social sciences and public policy, one is the professional fields and sciences, and one is the arts and humanities. So being, I presume this person doing artworks would be put in the arts and humanities subcommittee. I haven't worked with that subcommittee closely, so I'm not sure what it is they're looking for. I think you have to be careful about, one of the important parts of this is that the adjudicators are going to be looking, or you want to be able to present a package that is clean, concise, and effective, so that the adjudicators don't have to go searching for information. They can readily see the quality that's being presented to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's more an aspect of presenting quality work than the quantity itself. So we are at the end of our time. I hope that you were able to get a much more clear perspective on the whole process and the award and the requirements. As usual, we are available to answer any subsequent questions that you may have. You'll see the email on the last slide, info@fulbright.ca. So any questions that you have between now and November 15, please make sure to write us, and we will tackle any questions that come up. In the meantime, enjoy the rest of your week, and hope to see your application for this cycle. Take care. Thank you. Thank you, Brad. Take care.
Thank you, Paolo. Great session.
Bye. Take care.